Okay, I think we are live now, hopefully. Always a little bit waiting if things technically work out. So the webcam is there, I'm looking here at the laptop. It's a little bit a strange situation, but anyway. So welcome here to this live stream, a little bit of a different setup again compared to the live streams we had on at the desktop on my computer. Not talking too much today, we're going to play. I definitely need to practice a little bit, so no better way than inviting you as an audience to join me and listen. So this will be a very informal live stream, live practicing. So I will be practicing the Hexacodum Apollinis, which, as you know, I've recorded those six arias away a while ago. They're here in LP. There's a link in the description if you would like to have one. And actually, I'm just checking my live stream now. So, okay, Aina's in the chat, that's okay. So, it's working. So, but I have some concerts with the Hexacodum, and it's been 6-7 months. So, we're going to see what still is there. And of course, the music is playable. It's not very easy though, it's tricky sometimes. But we'll see where we come. So I may just play from the first note to the last one, or just make repeats anyway. So the focus needs to be built up again for Pachelbel here at my clavichord. So Philip Daniel, hello. It might be a little bit wrong hour. Normally you expect a 5 p.m. Monday video with music, but to be honest, last week I was a little bit sick, certainly in the weekend. Not a flu, but very close to that. So 3 days in my bed, and then this week. So last week I had to cough a lot, still sometimes. So my schedule was messed up really completely. And so I planned actually to record for you one or two Waldtempel de Clavier of Bach again. So I'm still working on playing all of the first book at the first place and record them then when they're finished. But it didn't work out. There was no possibility that I could concentrate, and I felt physically just not capable of doing that. Bastille, hello. So that's the reason why I thought, why not having a live stream practicing Pachelbel with you together? It's a little bit wrong hour, I believe, because Brazil and Mexico are going to play their second half. But later was not an option either, because tonight the future world champion is going to play Belgium against Japan, and so of course we have to watch that game. No, a little bit of a joke, but we're going to watch anyway. And I'm happy to be married to a wife, to a woman who is actually a bigger football fan than myself, so we watch football together. How cool is that? T. Alexander. And Arthur Zumhoff, welcome here. So, yes, all the instruments are mine, and there is a piano forte coming that we saw yesterday, actually. More on that in a future video, maybe on Wednesday or next week. So if I have to cough or to sneeze or whatever, I hope you'll excuse me. Okay, so without further ado, I will be looking at this chat sometimes from I don't know, but this is a recording. This is not a recording session, it's a practicing session. So, okay, hope you like it. There we go. I start with the first one and then I just continue with the second one, or I play the first one again. We'll see. The microphones are the main microphones, but the sound will be different because I'm using a transportable, not... It's an okay mixing console, but it's not the sound that you're used to hear from me. Marcus, welcome. Eriken, hello from Tokyo. Okay, interesting. So, tonight, Belgium, Japan. I'm sorry to tell that Belgium is going to win, but anyway. That's football. Okay, there we go. Thank you. I'm sorry, but I'm still recovering from a really bad cold last week. So that was the start. The thing is, if you know it yourself probably, that if you can play a piece and then time goes on, that's the first return to Pachelbel, and of course he notes that's still okay. But the focus is something you have to regain, refocus, reconcentrate in a way. And the only way you can do that is by playing. So I'm going to do it again. The trills, by the way, they really suck. There's nothing you can do about that, other than practicing them slow. But I don't have time for that now. So I'm just going to play and they will come by themselves. I have done some things here in the garden. And that's not good for your fingers, for the fine motoric, at least with me. Just saying hello in the chat. Robert, yeah, variations, arias, from Pachelbel, 1699, this recording here. By the way, if you haven't seen this on LP, it's a very nice feeling to just take it out. You see, those are the six arias. Classical music and vinyl, nobody actually knows if that's something that's going to be kind of hype. I don't like the name, but it's a kind of future, but I like having this so much. Andy is in the chat, great. Paul, Jason, wish I could stay the whole session. My teaching calls, okay, but there will be a replay. And by the I hope I don't have to cough too much. Okay. Arthur writes he feels confident for the Belgian team. Yeah, I hope so. Well, we're proud actually on our football team. Such a small country. Kriev, thank you. I hope it, Adam, it's 8 a.m. for you. Okay, great. Okay, we start again. Just, and then we continue with the recording, by the way. I haven't followed the order of the six arias because of it starts in D minor, E minor, F major, G minor, A minor, and then it returns to F minor, which is a little bit weird if you hear them on a recording in a row. So I changed the order and function of the keys actually, and I'm happy with that. But today I'm going to play them just as they are. Thank you.
Thank you.
That's so nice music. Oh. So when I just started to play Pachelbel, of course it's Chacona in F minor, this one. Was known to me, and the hexachordum is, of course, I knew it existed a few years ago, even that short. But then I started to play the Arda Sebaldina, the last one, and then the other ones, and you have to find a way to play it, because it seems to be easy, but it's like it has this Mozart-like level, actually. There is not one note too much. And so, before you find your way into that, so that you, yeah, let's not go into detail here, because I would be talking 30 minutes, but you have to find this balance that everything goes smoothly, there's this movement, but at the same time you have this dynamic differences, and music's not standing still, but you have these accents and a little bit of inequality even, so unequal notes, it's all in there. Then there is a new world opening, and now I'm really happy that I did this live stream, because just playing it from the first note to the last one, which I rarely do, you build up your focus and concentration, and the music is so nice to play. It's from the outside, Pachelbel seems to be easy and a little bit, you know, it's the canon in D, and then you have some other pieces, but this is really, really high level. So interesting that Buxtehude was the dedicatee, one of them, with Tobias Richter. The Buxtehude was the most famous one. So Pachelbel dedicated this work to him. And so Bach has for sure played this when he visited Buxtehude, 17, whatever, 7 or something. Okay, so if you have something on your mind, I'm not going through the chat now completely, because I would be... I hope you like this. And by the way, if you are still doubting for this recording, there is also a CD coming. Actually, today the artwork for that, a little bit of a delay, is finished. It's sent to MediaDub in the Netherlands. There it will be pressed. And so we expect the CD to be here next week, in 10, 14 days. Anya knows more details about this. Of course, this is the final disc, that's our... We are very proud on this. I showed at the beginning, just to open that and that. And it sounds really nice. It's very quiet and smooth, actually. So, the whole hexachordum is here. And always, when I re-practice those things, this music, just like with the Bach partitas, I really would like to record it again. I mean, I'm really happy with this. I would not change one note, but you develop new ideas, new accents. And honestly, a concert is different than a recording. There's different levels. Okay. William Emmanuel, greetings from Brazil. Well, I didn't see the second half of the match against Mexico, so I didn't know who won. If you won from... Anya's saying something.
2-0.
For Brazil?
Yes.
Okay, then if we win from Japan, we play too with against Brazil. Don't mention that movie Amadeus in front of him. No, I don't hate that movie, actually, Amadeus. But it's a beautiful movie, but it doesn't picture Mozart how he was. He was a hard-working guy who died at 36, not from chasing women, but for just working too hard. Just imagining what he wrote in 36 years. It's even too much. If you just would copy everything he wrote in his letters and music, it would take you some decades. So it's amazing. So the film Amadeus, we have to address some things about it, because that story lives on. That was not the Mozart. He loved his wife, for instance. There are all so many 19th century stories mixed in that movie, but anyway, it's about Pachelbel. But Pachelbel and Mozart, of course, is, yeah, incredible, but Pachelbel wrote much more music than we think. I think over 150 pieces are preserved, and if you listen to some of them, the influence on Bach is really immense. He's kind of a bridge figure. Brazil 2-0, Andy. Yeah. Was expected. Blake Simpson, I probably missed why it's called hexacorn. By the way, my voice will be a little bit roomy because that's picked up by the instrument microphones now. So it's called hexacorn because it are six, it are the strings of Apollo's lyre, so to say, which are six keys, six tonalities. D minor, E minor, E, F, G, A, but Pachelbel doesn't proceed to have a piece in B minor, but it returns to F minor. And the balance, very symbolic work. The 1699 is very close to Bach. We think of Pachelbel as 17th century music, but he died in 1707 or something. Should know it. I have a look at my own notes. 1706. But in a way, he was opening a lot what would be taken up by J.S. Bach later. Only see the F minor piece, this Aria Sibaldina. Connecting that to temperament is really interesting because he's going really far. And so Bach comes with his 24 keys, well-tempered clavier, of course, in 1722, but already then has been done a lot of things by people like Pachelbel and others. So there is a crescendo, so to say, of novelties, also technical difficulties that are here. And we, of course, we have played later music. I mean, and in conservatory, I practice piano also, 5 hours a day, Liszt etudes and Rachmaninoff. So we it's hard for us to tell how new this music was technically, because it seems for us easy music, but at that time it was really new. Big giant step, very symbolic way, that work. And that's one of the reasons why we choose that for Atlantic Sounds to record it first, because the Bach partitas, the six big partitas, they were recorded before, almost more than a year ago. The production is of course much bigger, that it will come in the end of this year, but also Pachelbel is a logical start. So that's the answer to the hexacorn. Hexacordum Apollinus, oh, Apollo, that's the god of music, I guess. Hope I don't say stupid things. Did Bach ever acknowledge his influence of Pachelbel? He was, I think, a modest man. Well, that's what the 19th century made of all of those people. I think he was modest in a way that the kind of post-industrial revolutionary individuality in as we have today, you know, we are all our own bosses, we have our own way of thinking, we are individuals amongst a community. In that time, that was different. Bach wrote his music to honor God and to serve his patron, so to say, whether it would be a count or whatever you call that in English, or just for the church in Leipzig. But that he was aware of his status as a musician, there's no doubt about that. So he was maybe modest in his way of acting, but he knew that he was Bach, like Beethoven knew he was Beethoven, like Mozart knew he was Mozart. You can see that in very in different things. So did he acknowledge the influence of Pachelbel? Well, I don't think, not really. Honestly, I don't think he did. But Bach was very much like Mozart also in a way. You know, Mozart traveled a lot, surprisingly, actually. He spoke 7 languages, if I remember well, so he was prepared to serve at any court in Europe. But this influence he got, and from all the composers, the music that he heard, or the composers that he met, was gigantic on his work. And the same is actually true for Bach. What Bach did was combining or French influences with Italian influences. French influences that were huge in Northern Germany, Italian influences that were huge, of course, in the music of Pachelbel. There are almost direct links to Italian music. So they had two, not competing styles, but styles that changed a lot. We came from the 17th century. I mean, music of Zweling was not so far ago. The mandrill notations or Renaissance music, that all changed in Italy, then France. Of course, not suddenly, but it came together in a few major composers, and that influence in Germany was huge. And Bach, well, he he managed to somehow take all these influences and bring it to a higher level. Not saying that his music is per se better than Italian or French, that's not what, but to a different level, so to say, a new style perhaps. And then combining that information with really new style of composition that you perhaps see in his, if you talk on the keyboard works, the inventions and the sinfonias, they are opening a way, in a way, to the Gallant music. It's contrapuntal, but it's opening. Like this music of Pachelbel is involving not only contrapuntal difficulties and beautiful things, like for instance in the music of Sweling, that you have this, it's not abstract, but the form is really important there. Here the message, the emotion, the effect becomes really important, and in Pachelbel's music, as an influence, as being influenced by the Italians. And that's something that Bach takes to another level, and that would lead to his son's second generation Bach students, so Emmanuel Bach's music. The style in which he wrote that was very much demanded at the end of Bach's life already. But in a way he prepared all of that, and so in a way you could say that Mozart, Beethoven as we knew him, was perhaps not possible without Bach. So very straightforward here. Okay. So as the acknowledgement was within this music, yeah, then, well, I'm not the most expert, the best expert in Bach's life and all everything he wrote, but a lot of things that Bach wrote he threw away at the end of his life, so he managed his legacy very well. You will not find any letters, recommendations, very few that survived by secondary sources for instrument makers or things like that, contracts that he must have had with instrument builders on his own instruments. There is a lot of information lacking, and that's all his own fault. He on purpose somehow kind of destroyed much that could lead to a reconstruction of all his life. He destroyed a lot of his early works, which is a pity, because there we really could have seen the influence of the old masters. In a way, Immanuel Bach did the same thing. So, yeah. Did Pachelbel play the organ? Yes, of course. He was, in that time, if you see today, people say, I'm a harpsichordist or this, that's actually a kind of neo-baroque naming of, in that time, you were a keyboard player. And at the highest level, you were organist as well, because there you had access to organs, and it was another status. Not by definition, but he was an organist. Yeah, okay. Well, I hope you enjoyed that.
There's one question.
Oh, Anya says something. One question?
Yes, from Dr. Foxlaw. He asked, what's the best version of our spinet harpsichord for practice for instrument?
Oh, here I see it. Foxlaw, Dr. Foxlaw, I'm going to ask, is it preferable to have a virginal spinet harpsichord as a practice instrument? Which should I construct? Well, if you have no experience in constructing instruments, then I would say perhaps look for a second hand. If your budget, I don't know what your budget is, visit some instrument builders, because you will have difficulties in constructing these kind of instruments. They are difficult. And certainly a clavichord is difficult. I would suggest strongly, if you have one instrument to choose, in that time it was a clavichord you needed to have. Because there you develop your touch in a way that on the spinetto virginal or harpsichord is not necessary. There you have a plucked instrument by that. Here you have actually a tangent, hits the string and it stays there. Very much like organ playing, but even more delicate. So if you can manage to play the clavichord, you easily can play on all other instruments. Not that the other instruments don't have their particularity, but the foundation is really strong then. So I would suggest either go to some instrument builders if you have builders in your environment living that are professionally building instruments, or perhaps look out for some second-hand instruments. So. Hope that helps. Yeah, Andy, and that's the question I will close this live stream with the piano. It was wonderful. I will make a video. I hope I can manage that for Wednesday. It's always difficult when we go to users. There's so much to discuss and to talk about. And then still we need to make a kind of documentary, which is difficult. It's much easier to turn on the camera here, prepare my speech or my script and just deliver that, upload it to my computer, add some B-roll, some information, some scores, some illustration, then go and visit somewhere where you have to kind of play a filmmaker. And so I have some footage on the piano and I will show and I will share what I have. But the piano is, well, it's beyond words. Actually, it's a little bit embarrassing in a way. Last minute decision was to have the ornamentation and done for the legs and for the whole piano as the original was. So you have these beautiful legs. They were carved in wood now and they were gilded. Well, it is a big decision for us, but yeah, the piano will be so beautiful, but it's really chic. So I'm really happy with it. So share about that very, very, very soon. And it was supposed to be ready now, but the mechanical parts are all ready. It's just a matter of assembling and some keys were working already. String material is almost there. It is specially casted now in a certain alloy, I think in Canada. So that'll come next week. Then the complete action will be assembled. Then it's just a matter of the finishing of the wood. So it's now black, but it's very matte. It will be very shiny, actually, kind of polytour, as we say in Dutch, polished. So different layers of polish will be on top of that, and yeah, then with the bronze and the gilt, gildings will be nice, really nice. Sound, I can't tell. It feels a little bit smaller than the era now. It will be great. So, a few questions here. What do you think if late starters in keyboard music that are interested in becoming professional? It depends, Leonardo asks. It depends very much what your age is, and that sounds weird, but there is a kind of development in our brains to play music, and I definitely will make some, by the way, I will make some videos on basic keyboard techniques. I did one, also have an online course, but I will do that more. The channel is now so much focused on tempo research that even the clavichord was a little bit forgotten, and so over the summer I will be writing a lot of things. We'll have a little bit of irregular schedule, so with perhaps a lot of live streams like this instead of recordings, I don't know. But I have to prepare also a little bit. I have to refocus the channel for September, October, and this part will come back. So our brain is actually must do a few things. You have to read the notes, so that needs to go very, very fast, so that you don't have to think. And then it has to actually set into motion a movement of your hand and your finger. So if you read a C and you have to play it with a second finger, without thinking, that needs to go in one flow, so to say, has to be converted into an action, a motorical action. And so there is an age where the brain stops developing those connections, and that's around, it depends, with 15, 16 years, and the students I've taught, is a kind of maximum limit. If you start as an adult, it's really hard to develop that finger-eye-brain coordination. And then you typically see, if you teach adults, they read a note, they think, they reflect, and then they give the impulse to the fingers, but that should be automatic. And if that is still there, then there's no problem. Otherwise, it's almost impossible to start later without that possibility and then become a professional. So, that's my advice. Is there anything in common with Guido Tarezzo's three hexachords? I don't know. Andy will know that perhaps, or John. Thinking to play the hexachord on the piano, and any advice? Yeah, just do it. It's no problem. The music becomes a little bit bigger, a little bit less direct, perhaps on a big Steinway or an upright piano, modern piano. I would certainly try with use of the left pedal to make a change in colors. Certainly if you are on the piano like an Erard, a little bit older one. But yeah, no problem. I think for Pachelbel, of course, it's 17th century music, but there you have also the bridge, the transition period to instruments. They were looking for keyboard instruments that had the same possibility of expression as a violin has or other instruments have or had. So it's no surprise that the clavichord, the fretted clavichord, became an unfretted instrument because it needed to follow the evolution of expansion of keys and temperament. And so a piano actually is much closer to a clavichord. So a Steinway is of course a long way, but in a way that's an evolution there, more than you could say from a harpsichord. A harpsichord is a different type of instrument. You can play a Pachelbel beautifully on a harpsichord, but you lose of course these dynamic possibilities for the moods and the things that are in this music. Of course, it fits so well, the clavichord, with that. So, play it on the piano, no problem. Why does your patron only have the option per video rather than per month? Okay, well, that's just an advice we got from a lesson from Patreon. So Patreon is the site where you can support the work we do by even $1 a month. So you, and yeah, no, it's 75, I believe. Looking to Anya, 74, 75. So that's a great way. By the way, we have to send out your rewards soon. It's with the Pachelbel that we are lit. And we have monthly hangouts. That's actually the biggest reward, I think. So we have video calls that you can just, like, you know, reading the chat, you can just talk to me and we can talk on everything, in fact. But per video is actually much easier than per month. But you can have set a cap to the amount of videos you want to support. So if you pledge $1, so to say, and you go in the settings, you get a question if you want to support all videos. I will not upload more than 3. That's the reason why I've described it as such. But you can set the cap to 1, so that you only support $1 a month, which is great. If a third of all the viewers would do that, and I'm not saying you should, then this would be a full-time job. But I'm really happy with the Patreons, because they are in fact the backbones. This also, this live stream is officially supported by them. Jonas answered one of the questions. I want to hear an interpretation of the Hammerklavier sonata on your Hammerklavier. Yes, of course, it will come. It's not possible on the clavichord. It's a little bit difficult. You need the right pedal, you need the piano for that. It's a Hammerklavier sonata. That'll come. I'm practicing on the Erard quite a lot, just to build up my repertoire of later Beethoven sonatas. So, to find a balance between those two. So, I'm working on the upper sonata. The Waldstein is almost finished. The Hammerklavier is in progress. That's a huge work. And difficult anyway, double beat, single beat, that's a really difficult work. Appassionata is also not easy. And I just started the Opus 90, the E minor. How is the sound clavichord? Beautiful. And at the same time working on Bach's World Tempi de Clavier on the clavichord. And yeah, again, I have to find the balance. For the hexachordum, I use the old Behrenreiter. I know there's a new one, but it's a nice one to play. So that's the most recent Behrenreiter. You have 2 versions. Okay, so Mike missed it, but no problem. As soon as I hit end live stream, this will be uploaded as a regular video. And there is something popping up. want to close. Been following you for almost a year now. I wonder, as talking about Musician Traveler, are you interested in Froberg's work? I don't remember any video of you playing it. I'm interested, and a lot of people asked for Froberg. So, since we have done Swirling now, I don't think there, and Pachelbel, there is no escaping Froberg. I would be happy to. Immanuel Bach is waiting. There is a pile of music waiting, even from Kostas, so the Greek composer. Wonderful works. Again, I have to rethink also a little bit the channel. I could do more music, of course, less videos in which we talk about some performance practice issues or just some musicology issues on tempo, but I have to rework on that. And we are now here in a transition period where both Anya and I have to do a lot of things that in, if you would consider this to be a company and a recording label, then there would be other people's involved also taking some tasks from us. And it's the transition is happening already, but of course we don't have the budget, certainly not now, to make that big jump. But we're planning in the future, hopefully, to have to expand the team a little bit so that I can free much more of my time to playing music and to do some research and share that with you, other than sitting at my computer and editing videos, because that's for a Wednesday video that takes easily about between 10 and 15 hours of not even thinking about the preparation. So recording, setting up everything, I should work to a system where I can batch record some videos so I can time it, but the editing is really hard. So that we expand our team a little bit and I can play more music and full back, yes, sure. I'll do that. There's some Bach works waiting also. Jan-Christoph Bach, yeah, arias, that's great. I don't know them. Arias P. Flaser. I think that the arias con variaciones of Jan-Christoph Bach are the same quality. That I will look into, because of course Pachelbel was his teacher, and J.S. Bach, J.S. Bach moved into Christoph's house when his parents died. I was actually planned to send to Pachelbel, but he went to Northern Germany. Gila's performing single Dorobit, I don't know. I don't know. I don't think he performs double beat. But sometimes you see great musicians not thinking and they just skip to that because of the music. Like Glenn Gould a lot of times actually. Then Slotoslav Richter also. Yeah, Michael, YouTube is really hard in sharing URLs. They see that as spam, and I don't know. And the regular videos, I always whitelist them, but okay. Theodore, so glad to support tonal music of modern era. I love the music of Kostas. Also, congratulations again on the success. Thank you very much. Yeah, Kostas is really a great guy. We have six easy sonatas waiting, which we would like to sent to music schools all over the place, just and with the kind of message that there will be a Facebook group connecting those people who play that works and meeting each other. That's a project with the name Connect. Okay, I see Evelyn there. She's coming back with my mother, and so you might hear them entering, so it's no problem, I hope. I thank you all for watching. I hope you liked this live stream. I loved playing it very much. I'm really happy with that. And if you would like me to do some more of these, don't hesitate to say that. Also practicing from scratch, just doing things like this, and there are a lot of things possible. So thanks for watching again. And if you're watching this and you're new to the channel, hit that subscribe button, also the bell icon. For many of you, perhaps, that say, hey, I missed this live stream, if you go to the subscription page or the home page or the bell icon, even if you subscribe, YouTube will not send all of you a message when a new video of a live stream is coming up. So the bell icon would enables that notification system. So, okay. And then finally, I thank my patrons, as I said, for supporting these productions. And if you would like to support our work, or just have a look, there is a link in the description box to our Patreon site. We'd be happy, even if you just checked it out. And all said, that was it for today. I hope to see you very soon again.